There is this BIS note talking about the turmoil of this last quarter continuing, typical of liquidity tightening periods. And then we've not seen a great performance in the US either on Wall Street. Do you think we're going to see this global growth concern grip us for some time now?
Yes, we will. And good morning to all of you as well. It's always a pleasure joining your show. So, look, I think what we have to recognize is that the U.S. peak growth momentum has really just passed. So when we look at Q1 through Q3, it's around 3.3% year-on-year. That drops this quarter down to 2.5%. And then we're on a lower path over most of 2019, between 2.2 to 2.5 on our estimates. So this is a somewhat lower growth path for the U.S. economy. The Chinese economy is slowing. We think it's going to slow from 6.5 to 6.2. The Eurozone is slowing. So this is we've actually reached peak growth momentum in the cycle. We're now starting to slow down to a slower plateau in 2019. And then we see some risks towards the end of 2020 in the U.S. of a recession, potentially from Q4 of 2020, but more likely into 2021. So the cycle is actually dominant. It's much more important, really, to be focusing on than trade wars, which we think will affect the timing of the downturn to some degree, or the amplitude of the downturn. But the cycle itself is very much in play.
Okay, so there are some risks of a recession in the U.S. towards the end of 2020. Paul, hi, good morning and thanks for joining us. And greetings of the season to you and your entire team at Daiwa. I'm going to come back to, you know, the U.S. markets in a bit. Before that, this year has been quite subpar for emerging markets and India. I mean, the MSCI Emerging Market Index is down 14% for the year, while India is down 11%. What's your own prognosis on how the first half of 2019 could shape up?
Well, we're getting more constructive on emerging markets, but still staying fairly defensive. So my focus is Asia-Pacific. So we've been, for more than a year now, we've been overweight Japan, underweight Asia ex Japan, overweight India in the context of Asia ex Japan, because we like the fact that the growth profile is not correlated very strongly with the global trade cycle. We see the prospects into next year improving because we see some of those pro-dollar dynamics or fundamentals starting to reverse. So hitherto, what has driven the U.S. dollar has been a combination of the relatively strong U.S. momentum, which we've just seen is now starting to slow. Number two is the hitherto guidance of Fed policy towards a previously guided neutral rate of around 3.25%. on the Fed's funds rate, but now we're hearing from Fed Chairman Powell that actually we're only just below the neutral rate. So that's obviously been shifted down. So that's a factor that's now starting to reverse a bit. And of course, the third factor that's been behind the strong U.S. dollar has been the trade hawkishness between the U.S. and China. And for a deficit country, a trade war over the short run is pro-dollar. Now, if we get some form of timeout on trade, Q1 next year, and those other two factors start to reverse, then you could see some level of reprieve in the U.S. dollar, and in particular in emerging market currencies, over the course of the next 12 months. Now, that will provide a certain tailwind, given the valuation discount in EM versus DM, particularly for those twin deficit countries that are large importers of oil, will also benefit from the windfall of weaker oil prices, taking the pressure off central bank tightening. Now, if this sounds familiar for India, there's good reason. Because in the case of India, you've got a twin deficit, you've got the worst performing currency in the region in 2019, still able to eke out a better performance overall in dollar terms than emerging markets as a whole, which is actually quite a performance. India is our top market for next year for those reasons, because we see non-correlated growth. We see, yes, valuation is a little on the expensive side, but I think it's justified given that the growth profile is non-correlated. And we see the scope, and I know this is non-consensus, we see the scope potentially next year of the RBI cutting rates.
Yeah, I know it's non-consensus, but there is a hope there after the recent inflation numbers. A final word from you, Paul Kitney. How should we approach the Fed meeting and the statement? Is it likely that we are going to get a confirmation of what Jerome Powell said, that they are pretty close to neutral rates? Can it be some kind of a seismic move, the FOMC statement?
Right. So the big change, the real big change, and we've already sort of got the last announcement. I mean, we've heard nothing from, you know, Jay Powell's last comments, you know, where he said that the Fed funds rate's now only just below neutral. Mm. And this is a big change because the Fed funds rate's 2.25. The previous indication of neutral was 3.25, which would have been, you know, 4 25 basis point hikes, including December over the course of the next 12 months. But that's now changed to the point where we're now seeing a neutral rate slightly above. Now, if we look at the Fed's policy reaction function, it consists of two variables, one backward-looking, which is the output gap, which really sort of looks at sort of, you know, where capacity constraints are in the labor market. And second, that doesn't change very frequently. Mm. So that's not what's changed. However, there's a forward-looking component to the policy reaction function, which is inflation expectations. So clearly, in order for the neutral rate to drop, is that the Fed's own projection of inflation expectations has fallen. Mm. Now, that could be energy prices. It could be the projection of the cycle and not wanting to overshoot and tighten just before the cycle turns over. Or it could be also an internal assessment of what the longer-term economic growth impact would be of the trade cycle itself. So I think we'll see two rate hikes. One possibly next week. I think there is a non-zero chance we don't get a hike next week. But I think the most likely scenario is we do, and then one more next year, and that's it for the cycle. And that probably means that we'll see some undermining of the U.S. dollar next year.